Today we are very honored to have with us Professor Alexandros Washburn, founding director of the Center for Coastal Resilience and Urban Excellence, Stevens Institute of Technology, and also visiting fellow with CLC. Professor Washburn was the former chief urban designer of New York City, and I'm sure he has many insights he will be sharing with us today about New York City's planning system and approach. And as a highly dense, highly livable coastal city, I'm sure we also have many lessons that we can learn from New York. The format for today's lecture will start out with a presentation by Professor Washburn, followed by a Q&A session with the audience. And in addition, we are also very honored to have with us Mr. Henk, Special Envoy for International Water Affairs of the Kingdom of Netherlands, as our fellow, as his fellow guest panelist today. The session will be moderated by Mr. Michael Koh, CLC Fellow. So let's put our hands together to welcome Professor Washburn.
My mentor was a man named Daniel Patrick Moynihan. He was the senior senator from New York when I worked with him back in 1993. But his career started much, much longer before. He used to work for President Kennedy. In fact, he was the Deputy Undersecretary of Labor there. His interest with cities started when, actually, the story goes, President Kennedy, during his inaugural, rode down Pennsylvania Avenue from the Capitol to the White House. And back then, in 1960, it was a pretty sad picture. People had been fleeing Washington. Washington was in decline. Anyway, the president said, "This is a disgrace." He turned to the most powerful man in his cabinet, Secretary Goldberg of Labor, and said to him, "Fix it." Well, Secretary Goldberg wanted to be a Supreme Court justice. He didn't want to fix cities. So he turned to his assistant, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, and he said, "You fix it." So it took Moynihan 3 decades, 2 political parties, but he finally did fix it. Senator Moynihan made Pennsylvania Avenue glitter. He made it America's Main Street. He made it so desirable that Donald Trump wanted to build a hotel on it. And in this strange paradox, the same year that Trump has become president, the Trump Hotel has opened on Pennsylvania Avenue. This is amazing transformation from something that was essentially an urban slum edge back long ago. But the way he did it was a combination of politics, finance, and design. You see, he was able to, by joining, this was actually very interesting, he was a Democrat, of course, and a big Democrat, but President Nixon asked him to come and work in the White House as a domestic advisor. And Moynihan agreed to do that, and as part of agreeing to do that, he was able to pass a law forming the Pennsylvania Avenue Development Corporation, PADC. That's the politics. That law allowed for public-private partnership that became very profitable. That's the finance. That's actually the same structure under which not President Trump had done this new hotel. Then Moynihan wrote the Federal Guidelines for Architecture, which set the very highest standards of design for the avenue, and that's the design. I can't tell you how grateful I am to Senator Moynihan for having taught me how cities work, but I also can't tell you how grateful I am for Mayor Bloomberg letting me practice what Senator Moynihan taught me. And now I'm going to show you 3 things that we did in New York of different scales and different times, but there are great successes. And when I say our, remember that an urban designer, even a chief urban designer, controls nothing, but has to influence everything. The first one is the High Line. How many of you here have been to the High Line? Almost, it's a very large percentage. It's the most popular park in the world per square meter. It's been an incredible success. But it started out as an abandoned rail line. You all know the story of the High Line. It was built almost 100 years ago under a program by Robert Moses as a way of improving a at-grade rail track that had been built a century before that by Commodore Vanderbilt. It was a wonderful feat of infrastructure, raising four tracks into the air. These railroad tracks would go right into giant factories. Amazing, amazing piece of infrastructure for 1933. But of course, those factories left. Manufacturing left the city. And the last time a train used that was 1982 for a trainload of frozen turkeys. After that, it was abandoned. But because it had been built so strongly, it didn't fall down. In fact, it just went to seed. Nature invaded it. And very interesting now the politics, now the finance, now the design comes into play. A group of very smart speculators realized that the land underneath the High Line had some value to it if the High Line could be demolished. You could build five stories under the zoning that existed here of manufacturing, which is not nothing, probably about $200 per square foot. But you first had to get it torn down. So they formed an organization and they lobbied then Mayor Giuliani to tear it down. And he agreed. But as part of that process, they had a public hearing. At that public hearing, two guys, ordinary guys from the neighborhood, Josh and Rob, met and said, you know what, this isn't a good idea to tear it down. We don't know what we want to do with this thing, but let's give it another shot. They formed something called the Friends of the High Line to fight this demolition order, to see how this strange piece of infrastructure running through their neighborhood could be reused. The story from there, it's a great story. I write about it in my book, and there's some other good books on it. But any one of you, if you've been allowed to go onto the High Line back in 1999, would have understood what it could be. I mean, this is a picture I took back then. We were actually, sometimes we would go on illegally, sometimes we'd go on with the permission of the railroad. But when you saw this, you realized immediately the potential. And Friends of the High Line got a photographer, Joel Sternfeld, to go back during the entire course of a year to photographing. Those photographs were printed in the New Yorker. They became a sensation. Suddenly the public was demanding that this not be torn down, and the Friends of the High Line had some momentum. Well, one of the Friends of the High Line was Amanda Burden. When Mayor Bloomberg won, he rescinded the demolition order and he made Amanda Burden chair of city planning. And that's where the story gets interesting. As chair of city planning, she directed the division to figure out a way to save the High Line. And they very quickly told her that it is impossible to save the High Line itself. It has to be done in context. And if you want to save the High Line, you're going to have to make a larger area affected by the High Line and capture the value needed to improve it in the area surrounding. So that's what led to something called the West Chelsea Special District. And you see the line drawn around it here. Very important as part of our process to state the public objectives. To transform the High Line into a unique linear park, yes. But also to provide market rate and affordable housing opportunities. New York City has a huge housing deficit. There's a chance now to make more. Also, preserve the good things about the neighborhood. The old manufacturing zoning, even though outdated for Manhattan, had allowed art galleries. A core of those was thriving, so don't get rid of those. And then the goal was to make this a 24/7 neighborhood and sort of mix the uses. And finally, the part that mattered for urban design specifically was to make sure that the new buildings that came up didn't hurt, but actually helped the High Line. The first step was the zoning change for manufacturing, first by adding residential at the edges, keeping the M zone in the center. This is the intersection of politics and finance, the trick that saved the High Line. The Friends of the High Line were doing great, but these people who wanted to tear it down were no slackers. These were actually some of the richest New Yorkers, some of the biggest developers who had speculated on this land. They did not want to see their investment go down the toilet. So they were fighting very hard. Either we were going to have to win in court, or we were going to have to figure out a win-win solution. And this is the win-win solution. It was come up by the old hands at city planning who remembered this from the fight to save Grand Central 2 decades before that. Transfer of development rights. There is a provision that allows you in New York to take a structure, a historic structure, and be allowed to treat it as a granting site. In exchange for not tearing it down, you are allowed to sell your development rights elsewhere. Now, in the Grand Central case, in the case that had survived legal challenges, you were only allowed to sell it next door or across the street. This was different. By creating a special district, we were allowing it to go very far away by zoning practice. And we're allowing it to go into a different use and also into a different height of the building. So put yourself now in the position of the enemies of the High Line who've been wanting to tear it down so they could build 5 stories of manufacturing in Manhattan, $200 a foot. Well, suddenly here's something that says they could build 5 stories in Manhattan, but it would be housing, $1,000 a foot to change. It would be housing at the top of new skyscrapers, $2,000 a foot to change a chain. So 10 times the value was being created for them. You should have seen that within hours, minutes of this law passing, the lawyers were down at the land office, filling out the forms, getting things stamped, getting the transfers done. It was amazing, the speed that this all turned over. And it was because of that understanding that you could solve this political problem through a design solution that created financial gain. From the design point, back here at Urban Design, you had to figure out, how does this touch or not touch the High Line? What's the right form for the buildings? And what we came up with was a set of, called bulk envelopes, that were sculpted algorithmically to ensure that light and air came down to the High Line and the views from and to the High Line stayed in place. The good news about this is that now it would allow any new building to hopefully improve, make the High Line like a jewel inside a setting of new buildings. And here's an example of how this actually worked in practice at 23rd Street. So this is 23HL, and this is 1100 West Street. This is where, had the High Line been torn down, the developer could have built their 5 stories right there. But because the High Line was saved and the legislation was in, he could use as much of the plot ratio as possible on site, very good location, and the rest he could sell to the top of this other development. The result is a Jean Nouvel building, a Neil Denari building, and the High Line Park. It's a home run. Everybody wins in this. I think it's a model for urban design, urban development all over the world. I know many people take it literally. I can't tell you how many cities came in to see us after the High Line's success, asking us how to create a High Line in their city. It's not the form that matters. It's the way that politics, finance, and design were brought together. It's the way a special district was created around the asset. And it's the way that the asset improved the area around it so that private money ended up doing public good. The leverage ratio that was achieved by this is phenomenal. For $100 million of public money spent on actually improving the High Line, $3 billion was spent around by the private sector. Now if you include Hudson Yards at the top, that figure goes to $10 billion. But just for the immediate area, the special district, that's a 30-to-1 ratio. That is higher leverage than even Lehman Brothers achieved at the height of the financial crisis. That's something special. Another one of our successes was Times Square. And Times Square, I'm sure everybody's heard of it, but how many have actually been there since we did the change? Okay, a good number here. What we changed, as you know, was that we made the piece of Broadway that runs through Times Square became pedestrianized, became a plaza. Times Square is what we call a bow tie plaza. It's also a very, very tricky intersection, although it's a major intersection. It's probably one of the top 5 intersections in New York City, where Broadway comes through and hits 7th Avenue. You could, if you asked your transport department to close down one major artery at one of their top five intersections, the answer would likely be no. The person who did this, the person that we can credit this to, is Jeanette Sadik Khan, who is our transport commissioner. And she's a very dynamic woman. When she was being interviewed for the job by Mayor Bloomberg, he asked her, well, why do you want to become traffic commissioner? These sort of tough interview questions. And she said, I don't want to be traffic commissioner. I want to be transportation commissioner. I want to think about how to get people from one place to another, not just cars. So he hired her, and like all of us, when he hires you, he said, don't screw it up. That's actually, it's very nice working for Michael Bloomberg. That's the only, he's a fantastic manager, because he lets you do what you're good at. And he just says, don't screw it up. And he means it. And if you do, you're fired. But if you don't, he'll back you. And he backed her. And the opposition to this was immense. So how did it actually happen? What's the nitty-gritty, the details of how this could be done? Well, it comes back to a couple of lines in administrative law. The Commissioner of Transportation is allowed to restripe lanes at her discretion without requirement for any further approval, because it's not a capital project. If Jeanette had said, I want to change Times Square and I want to make granite curbs and new benches and fancy lights, that would have been a capital project, which would have gone through a whole procedure that would have taken 2 years and would have probably been killed. Instead, overnight, pop up to paint, and then the permanent came only after political opposition had been silenced, because just like the High Line, the people opposed to this in the first place became its biggest proponents. The people who owned retail in Times Square, tremendously valuable in terms of turnover, in terms of dollars per square foot sales, thought that this pedestrianization was going to kill sales because cars wouldn't go through. Well, sales went up afterwards. So now they were supporters. Once they're supporters, now you can go into the capital program and you can improve this. And it's just finished actually a couple months ago. But here it is in a state of paint and actually sand. Let me actually back up just a second before I move on to our next one, show you this picture. This is Tim Tompkins. He is the president of the Times Square Alliance to Bid, the sort of public-private group that works to improve and program the area. I'm showing this not just because he's a great guy and does a wonderful job with Times Square, but I'm showing this because as we're taking this picture, a bomb went off. That was a car parked a block and a half on the left, but the bomb did not, the ignition went off, but not the bomb. Terrorism is a huge subject in New York, and we've been talking in my workshops and stuff about hazardous materials and nuisances and adjacencies. There is, in New York, a constant threat of terrorism. We spend enormous amounts of money to fight it, enormous, but we've been hit many times. The first World Trade Center bombing, the second World Trade Center bombing, these bombs, it's a fact of life there. But it doesn't stop us. It doesn't stop anyone. And making Times Square pedestrian, doing some of these changes, again, if you love your city, you change your city. Question what is challenging you at any given moment and overcome it. Now let me get back to the design. Streets, the vitality of street life. Well, that's what we never give up as New Yorkers. Nobody, just because a bomb went off in Times Square doesn't mean that people don't go to Times Square anymore. Everybody goes there, everybody walks. And it's the walking that really makes New York unique. I mean, how many songs are there about the sidewalks and streets of New York? I mean, Frank Sinatra, Alicia Keys, Jay-Z, even back in the jazz age, people would sing about New York's streets and sidewalks. In the rest of the world, pedestrian means just that, blah. But in New York, pedestrian means fabulous. And that did not happen by accident. That was one of the chief focuses of the Department of City Planning under Amanda Burden. She would put us to work drawing streets over and over again. And the point is that there's a finite amount of space between the property lines. The public right-of-way is small. And in that right-of-way, you have to fit an enormous number of different functions. Everything from a bike lane to a truck lane to a tree. So if you try to fit them all in, you realize they do not fit. You can't have everything. So the point of this exercise is to show that the design of the sidewalk, the design of the street, requires making a decision, a political decision. What's more important, what's less important? If you believe in sustainable transportation, you will think a bike lane is important. If you believe that cars have an unfettered right, you will put in parking lanes, you will put in drive lanes. Somebody has to decide. And that decision reflects the values of the society that makes the decision. I'm very proud that New York now has a bicycle network that is one of the greatest in the world. This shows a commitment, and it's used more and more every year. The City Bike Program is an incredible success. It proves that our values are correct, and it's something that every city has to make a choice on. And I know that Singapore faces this choice quite a bit. And frankly, even crossing the street to get to the URA, I can tell you, I suggest a tune-up of this. But look, this is now the goal is to take those values and turn them into an art and turn them into a science. This is a street that we were designing at the edge of a new development on the East River, showing how we analyzed the various space allocations between, used it as a tool to gain consensus, and finally made this design, which is now built, where we have bicycle lanes, park lanes, walking lanes, and very little traffic lanes. Yeah, this is actually a funny story on this. I shouldn't digress to keep things moving here. As a professor, I always digress. But so when we were working on this, the transportation consultant showed an intersection. And I said, well, where's the crosswalk? And he said, oh, I'm sorry, the volume of right turns is so heavy that there's no ability to put a crosswalk. No, there's going to be a crosswalk there. And the guy looked at his handler from the Department of Transportation, who also looked at me and said, like, who are you from City Planning to tell the Transportation Department what to do? These are our consultants. Now, I knew that Jeanette was going to become Transportation Commissioner. Our kids went to school together, we've known each other for a long time, but this employee had no idea. So I said, no, there's going to be a crosswalk. And of course, the next day she was announced as Transportation Commissioner, and from then on, crosswalks ruled. And to his credit, that employee became one of the biggest advocates of biking and crosswalks. I think later on became in charge of the bike program at City Planning. You know, I think that's an interesting thing politically and administratively. This person, he felt his job was to fight for the party line, cars, even though he himself believed in bicycling. He believed in something different, but he was just doing what he was told. And the sort of, to see him blossom, grow, when he was allowed to do what he thought was right, was amazing. And that happened over and over again during the Bloomberg administration. You find people who've been at their jobs for years that somehow realized how this all fit together. How designing a tree pit affected a flow, affected a block, affected a neighborhood, improved a city. And That's something that urban design has the power to unlock, showing how the smallest changes can work towards the largest goals. So, with a grant from actually the Centers for Disease Control, because there's a very large incidence of diabetes from obesity, especially childhood obesity in New York, we got a grant to study sidewalks and to make a manual of sidewalk design. So we call it the pedestrian point of view, and we treated every sidewalk as a room. You know, we have architecture as a background. So we figured that if we took it on almost as an architectural project, we could finally get people to understand that a sidewalk and a block is a piece of public space and should be thought of in all dimensions. Now to tie it back into administration, we've broken up into four planes: the sky plane, the ground plane, the shop plane, the road plane, and under each one of those listed all the elements of streetscape: trees, lights, facades, benches, sidewalks, flooring, et cetera, et cetera. But then we traced those elements to the agencies that regulated them and to the form of regulation that each one was under. And typically you'll find that regulations come in four flavors: regulations that allow you to do something, regulations that encourage you to do something, but then again, ones that require you to do something, and then regulations that have to simply be removed. Each of the regulations should have some relationship to a policy goal, and will have a relationship to a policy document. So again, we traced all of these through and eventually came up with this manual for active sidewalk design that took on each of these planes and then put them all together into a sidewalk room. This exercise was instructive for us, but we feel it was also instructive for other cities. Because anyone who follows through on this work plan learns that these elements are tied to larger policies and learns that these are regulated by different agencies, but doesn't give up. Once you understand the system, now as an urban designer, you feel empowered to be able to work things and understand how you're going to change things. You're probably all familiar with the Noli plan of Rome from, I think it's the 17th century, where black indicates areas private and white is the public space, and he showed the interior of churches as public space. Well, we decided to update that and call something the Strolli plan. It's a finer-grained version of the Noli plan, and it's meant to talk about the world from a pedestrian point of view in the city. So the whitest areas, the lightest areas, are the most public. The darkest are the ones that you can't go. So the streets are relatively dark in our case, because you can't walk in them when they're cars or bikes. Retail is in between. And of course, areas that are truly public are bright white. And we also take another step, go beyond black and white to include green, so that we can keep track of our street trees and the shading and the absorption that they do. It's a very useful technique. I encourage, you know, young designers here to analyze what they do with this point of view. It's a pedestrian point of view. It's a gradient from public to private. And that's really all in the service of something I believe, that to build a great city, build a great sidewalk. Okay. Chapter 2 is the future bottom up. See how we're doing on time here. Okay. Let me talk about my career for a little bit. I started out at the federal level. I was then the president of a state corporation. Then I was a city employee as an urban designer. But most people would think things have been going the wrong way. Like, you're supposed to start out small and work your way up to the federal government level. I've been doing the opposite. I used to have an office on the 63rd floor of the Chrysler Building when I worked for Senator Moynihan. Now I look out of my house. What's happened? Is this a disaster? No. I think now I am more effective than I've ever been. And this is the ground floor of my house, and this is a community meeting where we've gotten together to talk about the integrated flood protection system for Redwood, Brooklyn. It's open to the street. It's open every week. People just knock on the door or walk in. And it's approaching planning at a finer grain than we were ever able to do before. And now I'm going to show you a little bit at the end of the lecture about what we're doing as a community. But I have an inkling that the future is bottom up, that things are changing. Certainly in America, we are not relying on we're not waiting for government anymore. In fact, we've just elected someone who has vowed to destroy government. I know it's an actual policy about, I think it's it was stated as to remove the administrative state. The destruction of the administrative state. That has real implications. So we may be ahead of the curve a little bit, but I'm telling you that if you want to change things now, change it from the bottom up. We have new tools now, we have new powers, so the bottom up actually can be quite powerful. And what you can suggest does not need to be very small. It can be as large as a region, but it still starts from a neighborhood plan. Well, in my career, a couple of other stops, I wrote a book called The Nature of Urban Design to talk about what I learned while a city planner. So much of what I'm talking about today is in the book. And then I also went to be a teacher, be a professor at the Stevens Institute of Technology. This was after my house was flooded during Hurricane Sandy, and I worked with a group that would combine urban design, hydrodynamic modeling, and complex computational modeling. And here's our web page view of the waters in New York Harbor. We have over 200 sensors in New York Harbor. My colleagues are fantastic hydrodynamicists. Actually, I used to work for Michael Bloomberg, now I work with Alan Blumberg. Alan is publishing a book on urban oceanography, how do oceans behave in cities, near or in cities. Very important because it lets us understand the water, and understanding the water lets us understand the land and how we should plan for it. But at Stevens, which is a very, very good technical university, this was the standard diagram of resilience. Shock event, live or die, muddle through and come back, and then resilience would be measured as a percentage of recovery in a unit of time. If you then took various aspects of a resilience system and analyzed it in this way, you would come up with a mathematically relatively accurate description of the system resilience. Great. Great diagram with only one problem, and that is it's wrong. Why is it wrong? Well, if you come back at only a percentage of your previous function and you have a repetition of the event, you eventually go to zero. Right? This is not a diagram of resilience, this is a diagram of doom. The diagram of resilience is this, that you come back better, you come back stronger. And this is the diagram of urban design. Now, urban design, remember, we want to leave things better than we found it. It's the essence of cities. That's why I think cities are so resilient. Even before scientists came to study it, cities knew about resilience. And I'll go so far as to say that this, resilience is the product of civic virtue. And what is civic virtue? Now I go back to my mentor, Pat Moynihan. Whenever I managed to say something smart about cities, he'd say, spoken like a true Athenian. I thought he was referring to my mom. I'm half Greek on my mom's side. But I didn't realize what he really was referring to. I didn't realize it until after he had died. We were going to his memorial service. And his service was held at the Syracuse University School of Public Service, where he studied. And when I saw it, I finally got it. It was written up on the wall, chiseled on the wall, past a door that he would go through every day, was something called the Oath of the Athenians. And that oath, which every young person in Athens had to take when they became a citizen of Athens, was to do three things. One, revere the gods. Two, obey the laws. And three, leave the city not less but greater than you found it. Leave it better than you found it. That's urban design. That's why cities are resilient. Every shock is not just an opportunity, it's an oath, a requirement, a pledge to build stronger. We have to keep this alive today. Now that we understand urban design as politics, finance, and design, we have to be able to bring a notion of civic virtue to every one of those. When a politician makes a decision, it has to be to leave something better than we found it. When a financier makes a loan or investment, they have to think, am I doing good? Am I going to make something better? And most important for us as designers, we have to pledge that what we do makes us stronger and not weaker, makes our city more resilient, more socially unified. It's demanding us to think much more broadly than we do now. In fact, if all of us took that oath, we could no longer specialize and focus only on what we do. We would have to think about how what we do affects our whole city. I think at this point, I see that I'm out of time. I have a lot more that I can show you about Brooklyn, about Singapore. I'm not sure how tough our time is right now.
Go on for about 10 minutes.
Go for 10 minutes? Okay. All right. Well, 10 minutes then. Let me tell you then a Brooklyn story. I live in Red Hook, Brooklyn. How many people here have been to Brooklyn? Okay. Well, Brooklyn is the place you go to in New York when you want to make something. It's the most creative place in New York. And our corner of Brooklyn was flattened during Hurricane Sandy. We had 5 feet of water. And every year we have a parade to mark that. We call it the Barnacle Parade. We build a Noah's Ark, we parade it through the streets, and then we end up at Sonny's Bar. This is us. Old warehouses, old factories. It's where we used to build ships in Brooklyn. On the waterfront, right there in the harbor, in the middle of New York Harbor. 25 minutes by bicycle or 15 minutes by kayak to Wall Street. Now, every one of my neighbors is there to make something. Viviana, she makes justice in something called a community justice center, which is an innovation to keep people out of the court system and to treat minor offenses right here in the community. Joe is learning how to fly drones as part of a grant we have to use drones to make FODAR images, three-dimensional dynamic models of cities, digital city models. And they're socio-technic because they're made with people from the community. Ahmed, he makes chairs. He's a great designer. It's a very beautiful chair. And Debraya is in charge of a public Wi-Fi network that we're putting up to give ourselves a resilient backbone during the next day. Community and character. I think that it's important to talk about character in a community. Resilience is related to character, but character is not related to cute cafes. Character is something that's only revealed when you're tested. And we, of course, were tested during Hurricane Sandy as a community. Here's a storm as big as the east coast of the United States, and there's Little Red Hook there in the center. And what this storm did to us is really bad to remember. This is a picture from my house. Remember, we in Red Hook have a combined sanitary and storm sewer. So when you get a storm surge coming off the Atlantic, it's like a toilet overflowing. It is horrible. It left everyone's houses, everything that it touched, it destroyed. Billy the pitmaster had been preparing a new barbecue restaurant for 6 months before Hurricane Sandy hit. And it hit just a week before he was set to open. Well, what did he do when his restaurant was destroyed? He wheeled out a portable cooker and started making lunch for everybody. What did the rest of the people came from all over the sea to help us? They volunteered to clean it out. And they didn't want any thanks. They didn't want any money. It's very touching to remember this for me. People being part of a community, building social resilience. It makes me understand that social resilience really is as important as physical resilience. Now, in physical resilience terms, this is the extent of flooding during Hurricane Sandy. And the city after this proposed that we would get a wall. There would be $200 million for a new wall, but they didn't tell us what sort of wall it would be. We don't want a wall like this one in Japan that's being built near Fukushima. If we are going to have a wall, let it be something more like the wall on the right, which is an old fort in Copenhagen. So we would like to follow the Dutch model and have a polder offshore rather than a wall onshore to protect us. And as a community that's created, what we did when we found out that the government didn't have the money to build this wall they were promising us is we decided to make our own plan with half the money, half the wall. We picked the hook of Red Hook, and we suggested we build another offshore island with the reservoir in between, and map city blocks and streets onto that island. So it would be a polder, and it would be a seawall. And it would also help solve our stormwater problem. This is the catchment area during the rain from around my house. The red and the yellow are our sewers and pumping stations, which are a disaster. They broke 2 years ago and flooded our basements with raw sewage as well. So we have to find a way of getting the stormwater out of the system. So what if we simply pumped it over to this new reservoir we built, filtered it, and then let it discharge back into the sea? Well, if we build this and we map these streets on, we've made new maritime areas for commerce. We've made a new canal and a reservoir between the industry and new housing. And most importantly, this flood wall is now no longer concrete. It's a park. And behind this park can be new housing. And that's literally the view you have in Red Hook, sunset over the Statue of Liberty and the Freedom Tower. So, how are we going to pay for it? Well, we believe it can pay for itself. The red, salmon colored, is stuff that costs money, building this new boulder. The green is stuff that makes money, land, building rights. Now, the way we've calculated it out, in New York, we've got about $100 a square foot for building rights. In Brooklyn right now, it costs about $100 million to build this boulder and its infrastructure. We think we've got about 1 million square feet of new development, so we think it can balance out. So, where do we take it? The next steps. We do the hydrodynamic modeling with Stevens. It's going very well. We do fine-grained real estate modeling, every building, every floor, every use. That's the finance, and then the politics. We figure out the approvals pathway. What is the law behind building an island in New York? Who owns it? How do you do it? So we did some research and we found out in 1923, the governor of New York signed a law passed by the legislature of New York to build an island in New York Harbor. And this was amazing to us, and this was the island. And we'd just been proposing that little strip there by the green, but what was approved in law, albeit law from 1923, was this enormous breakwater island just to the south of Red Hook. But where is it? You look at the aerials and you can't see it. But if you look beneath that to the bathymetry, you see that triangular area. We started to build this island and then we stopped 3 meters below sea level. But it's there. That is not a natural shape, that triangle. That's man-made. So what does an urban designer do? We map blocks and streets on it. We map a park, a new ecohabitat on the water side and the harbor side, and then we map more maritime on the land side. Essentially, we make this island a new part of the city. To do it, to get the approval, we have to improve habitat. So that's why the edge to the harbor will create biodiversity as part of the park that is also our seawall. And we also create jobs on the land side by adding a second dimension to the docks that are already in Sunset Park. So to pay for itself, we follow the same logic. In fact, we use as a precedent a Dutch model from Rotterdam. Analyzing that, and I know I'm under a little bit of time constraint, so I'll go quickly. But the bottom line is Red Hook Island is 12 million square feet. The Dutch precedent offers 55% of that land to be put into private use. At an FAR, a plot ratio of 5, which is sort of a medium density for New York, you get 35 million square feet of development. To build this island with its infrastructure is $3.5 billion. The value of 35 million square feet of development in Brooklyn today is $3.5 billion. There is a rough equivalency here. This could pay for itself if you can figure out the financing. So to conclude, I want to go back to the sense of urban design. This is a new way of developing. This is an experiment. You'd say, since when can a community planner or a private citizen make change like this? But look what happened with the High Line. Look what Josh and Rob did. Big things now can come from small groups of people. So I would say, don't plan, but experiment. See if it brings life. When that life is there, there's a great quote by Jan Gehl, first the life, then the space, then the buildings. Make an experiment. Capitalize on success. Urban design is about transformation. An urban design is not a master plan. An urban design is a project that changes the life around it. So if you can figure out a way of aligning the politics, the finance, and the design, if you can figure out a way of making each one of those steps contribute to the civic good, then you will find a way of making great change happen. That's the purpose of urban design, and that's the reason to be an urban designer.
I'd like to talk about and involve Henk in this as well from the European level, because we've got examples of the High Line. The examples of Chicago 606, and we have Superkillen Park in Copenhagen. All these are parks that have reused spaces that were disused or in bad condition, and they all kind of came up with the idea of linking different neighborhoods together, being spaces for the people. The Chicago 606, for example, was formerly the Bloomingdale Trail. It links different neighborhoods, rich and poor, together. Superkillen as well, linking rich, poor neighborhoods together. And the whole process, including the High Line, was that of a community process. And as Alex was saying, and through that process, actually, you got the rich, the poor, coming all together. But look at the results today. The High Line now, it's touristic. Millions of visitors, as is the 606 and Superkillen. And what does that mean? I mean, the original community had gone together to create a community space, yet now many of them feel disassociated from the community space. And the other criticism is that of gentrification. I think Richard Florida has written about it in his letter, admitting that he was wrong asking the creative class to come in and gentrify the spaces because it has chased people out. people now can't afford to live there. And I think one of the founders of the Highlander come up to say that, you know, he sees that point of gentrification. So I just want to perhaps start with going, yes, there's great success, we all look at it as success, but how did it, what is it in relation to the original intent of creating the space for the community to bring the neighborhoods together when the neighborhoods now can't afford it and some people have to move out, etc. So is this a positive aspect or is it a negative aspect? Just for discussion. Maybe Alex and then Hank?
Yes, the issue of gentrification is a particularly important point. The question of gentrification in the Highline area, though, is a little bit different because the Highline was entirely manufacturing zone beforehand, so there were very few people who were actually there. I can maybe talk to the question as it would apply to Red Hook. Well, Red Hook has the largest public housing development in Brooklyn, Red Hook Houses. And our issue of gentrification, I actually see as a little different. Our goal in Red Hook is to unify. It's to bring people from the houses community to participate more and share more of Red Hook with the people who don't live in the houses. We're making strides to this, but how do you do that? Well, the way you increase community, and that's an active process. You have to do, in other words, if you want to increase, if you want to know your neighbors, just walk out the door and talk to them. I guess this is what I'm trying to tell you here. That we talk about community all the time, but community does not, there's no legal definition of community. Community is something that you make. So you need a project to work on together to make community. But part of your success will be in the bonds that you make with your neighbors by working together to create something. And that would be my greatest hope for this next phase of Red Hook, is that what we do is meaningful and exciting and impossible to do without doing together. And by doing it, we create a social community as much as we create a physical neighborhood. And just like I felt when Billy came out and fed us, that social community is as, if not more important than the physical setting it's in.
So, before gentrification, one clarification. I think Alex is not so much deregulated, I think what is critical, also part of his lecture, was very much the capacity to understand all levels of the system, make it possible to be able to act upon it. So, politics, finance, and design. Alex understands the system, therefore can be relaxed because there is this level of understanding that makes it possible to act and interact. The political system is often the least understood. But once you grasp it, you get the high line. Only if you can understand the complexity of rules and regulations, finance, development, interest, and so forth, you're able to come up with an intelligent approach. If you lack that understanding, then deregulation won't get you anywhere. So, bottom up or top down, without knowledge, both fail. Without an inclusive process, both fail. Without collaboration, both fail. So it's not only the approach from the bottom up or top down, it's actually the knowledge based from a comprehensive part of all layers that is as a necessity. And this morning I used von Humboldt as an inspiration. It definitely is true. Understanding the environment and the ecosystem, understanding mankind and humanity and economics, and understanding politics. Those three levels of understanding are critical to, you know, start a community. Second, to your last point, would be worthwhile almost to invite him here, but I think Eric Kleinenberg was a fellow at CLC. And perhaps he talked about Chicago heat. And when Chicago was hit by the worst heat wave ever, Professor Kleinenberg, a good friend Eric, who runs now the Institute for Public Knowledge in New York, did a research on, okay, what actually, not only what happened, but how did communities live through this heat? And two communities next to each other, same poverty rate, same unemployment rate, same demographics, so age, Afro-American, Asian, American, and so forth. But one with a strong community tie, where people knocked on each other's door and took care of each other and helped out, and the other, no community tie at all. The death rate in a community without the community tie was high. The death rate with the community tie was zero. This social resiliency is critical. Last, to your point of gentrification, I don't know anything on gentrification in Redhook. I'm not a resident, although I visited Alex home and I'm here, we had dinner. And of course, you know, after Hurricane Sandy, working there, seeing the prep factory pick up, set up shop again, you know, I've reached them then. But I do have experience on the Lower East Side in Manhattan. And the Lower East Side in Manhattan, is an amazing place because it's not gentrified. And that scare actually brings part of, it's like almost paralyzing the community. So there is no subway system and they don't want the subway system because the subway system on the Lower East Side actually has the idea of, you know, economic opportunity and therefore gentrification. The Lower East Side got flooded totally after Sandy. Social housing, low-income housing, all over the Lower East. When I started to work in New York in the rebuilding after Hurricane Sandy, we started to engage also with the Lower East Side community. And the first thing they said to us, please leave us alone. Leave us alone. Not because they were not in trouble, because they've seen, they went through Sandy and everything was wrong. Social housing, you know, no electricity, and so forth. But they were afraid that by improvement, Build Back Better, improve the place, they would open up for development and gentrification. And we assured them that it was a very careful process of going back and forth and back and forth. That although we were part government, that we were also part community. And that collaboration actually meant it was true. So we sat down with them for days, hours, months, weeks, build a coalition that still is there, still strong. And now we are spending over $350 million in federal protection and aid money to build the best park that's gonna protect the community from flooding without gentrification opportunities. And I think gentrification is critically there in New York, as it is in a lot of the places and cities around the world. But having the ability from a government point of view and a community point of view to come together and address that question gives you at least the opportunity to develop plans and implement them in a different way.
It's an amazing project by, I think, a group of very dedicated team of planners, architects, urban designers, worked with community workers. They went out to the various neighborhoods. They actually solicited comments from the grounds up approach. What did each neighborhood want from the area? What did they want to do to the coastline? Yes, you know, they faced the danger of flooding. They were flooded out. But what could they want? What did they want to improve their local community? And how could they work together with agencies to create a much better environment for all? So truly a grounds-up approach. New York City is lucky to have funding for it. And unfortunately, as Alex said, Red Hook did not. So, but it's interesting to note that Red Hook is fighting back from a community grounds-up point of view. That little island that Alex showed that's been built to the Hook, he briefed it and said that when they first looked at it, there was industry and there was a layer of residential, but somehow or other the developer wasn't interested, but then they added that extension with the canal and more residential, and then the developer said, hey, that's a good idea. Now I've got residential facing the waterfront, I'm separated from industrial jobs and industrial users by waterway, which is great. And this brings me to the question of creating neighborhoods and the ground-up approach and the issue of mixed users. How do you determine that mix of users? I think in the High Line was very successful. I think you said you wanted to keep galleries, and hence the M1 zoning. You kept some of the meat packers as well in the area, which traditionally was there, were there. In the Red Hook example, you started off by saying we wanted to introduce industrial maritime jobs, and we put the residential right next to it. So how do you do that? Is it because you have created this as a special area, you form a development corporation to look at it? What is that success factor that makes New York tick? It's seen in High Line, you see it, Hudson Yards, etc. And other European examples as well.
Well, the special recipe, the way of determining the mix, is very simple. It's just called more woodland. This is just how we live. We walk to work. The industry is next to houses, is next to groceries, is next to offices. You can't really imagine a city that isn't mixed use. The idea of separating the uses really is something that's only as old as the Charter of Athens, you know, from 1923 or so. It only came into the zoning code in its current rigidness in 1961. Brooklyn's a lot older than that. And luckily, that has survived both physically, but also as a spirit. So when we want to improve our neighborhood, we have to think immediately. Jobs, schools, groceries, houses, public spaces, it's all part of a system. It's not housing, it's neighborhooding. And I guess it's a very good question, but the answer is just more Brooklyn. And save your consultant dollars and all that. Just go and look at a piece of Brooklyn and try to replicate the ratios, and I think you will have a good start on a wonderful mixed-use neighborhood.
One more Amsterdam door.
Yeah, okay. they speak.
It's okay. And Brooklyn. And Brooklyn actually was called after Brooklyn, which is a very Dutch town. But then we have to go more than 400 years ago. So I agree. But mixed use has a different layer. It depends on the approach you take, which of course is comprehensive and inclusive if you take all stakeholders part. And this is life. I do think there is a next level then to that. Because life is threatened because of the challenges mankind puts on the planet, for instance. And not for nothing did we agree on the Sustainable Development Goals, and did we agree in a Paris Agreement. A next level of mixed use is actually incorporating not only interests of everyone who lives there, but also think about the future, the ones that don't live there yet, the generations that come after us. And then, Alex, you said it in the lecture, never leave a place unless you leave it better. You said it a little differently, but there is no way forward unless we move up. And if we don't do that, that goal we set ourselves, SDGs and the climate agreement, all of a sudden become an ambition that is a nice to have. No. It's very serious. The SDGs and the Paris Agreement are a need. If we don't achieve that goal as a baseline approach, too many people died, and too many dollars, euros, yen, whatever currency you live in, were lost. So mixed use as an approach, for me, is not so interesting. It's about a comprehensive approach that is inclusive, and that is thinking about that long term and incorporating that long term today. If we're able to do that, the result is showcased in mixed use, like a lot of Brooklyns around the world, as inspirations for sure. And those brookstones are redundant and resilient, and therefore sustainable, and will be able to deal with those future challenges.
And I'd like to add from Alex's words, and those brooklands where being a pedestrian is fabulous, where there is vitality of street life, like what we see in New York and Brooklyn, many European cities where streets are perhaps regarded as assets for people and not for vehicles. Now I'm going to be a little pointed and naughty here because we made Alex, for example, walk the streets yesterday on Monday. I'm sure Henk has also walked the streets often. So is this an experience you find in Singapore?
Just walking here from my hotel, no, you failed. Really, Singapore, the best sidewalks I have found were in Tuas. We took a tour of the industrial district, and there's a beautiful, you know, perfectly tidy, I don't know, probably 2-3 meter sidewalk, and then a very nice row of trees. Here in the center of the city, there has to be much wider sidewalk capacity with much more continuous tree planting and a sense of continuous routes for pedestrians. I mean, this intersection right outside the door of the URA, where you're not really allowed to cross the street, where the street by the red building comes in, and then if you do jaywalk, there's only about a half meter wide perch to go on. You know, that's just wrong. And, you know, look, Singapore does some extraordinary things. It's one of my favorite cities. It's really the inspiration for a lot in my book. The Marina Barrage, I think, is one of the great civic projects that have been produced. But maybe the problem is you think too big. You know, maybe you think a public space is a public plaza or a brilliant roof where you can fly your kite. But every sidewalk on every block is a public space. It deserves the same care that the roof of the Marina Barrage got. And for everyday life, it is the most important space. And the dividends that come back from improving the street in front of your house will astound you. Just try it right here outside the door. And I'll come back and check on it.
And yeah, walking the streets of Singapore. I think that there is a difference between public space and a systems approach to public space. Because you have great public space, beautiful parks, like Alexandros or Bushan Park or wherever, you know. I've been around the island and it's amazing, beaches, parks, but there's not, you know, they're isolated, fragmented, incidents sometimes, very well planned, beautifully designed, more and more in line with future challenges or rain events and so forth. So I also think it's not far away, that opportunity. From thinking big and from project by project, to a systems approach can be a small step, since you've already done so much. If you fly over Singapore in a kite, you see a huge capacity already being developed. Understanding the systems approach from people's perspective, you know, walking by foot, just try to do it. And if every step is an investment in that network, in that system, then it's a step worthwhile. So, for sure, it's within reach.
Actually, Henk, I would like you to follow up a little bit. You've observed, and I totally agree, and I've stated so in some articles, Singapore has become a city for cars, not people. What can you recommend? What can we do to bring Singapore back to the people, away from the cars?
It's a question of values. Somebody in charge of the streets has to agree that the precious space between property lines is divided differently, apportioned differently. You don't have to pedestrianize everything, but you would have to elevate the pedestrian point of view to be as important or more important than the windshield point of view. The point of view determines everything. If you have the point of view of the windshield, every curve has to be the right radius for a car. If you have the pedestrian point of view, you don't need a radius. The corner sidewalk on the Asia Hotel, this Oasis Hotel, where right by the subway stop, where the corner has been green and the radius has been matched for a car turning, and the pedestrian has to make a zigzag and can't cross there. That's wrong. But that can be solved so simply, not from looking down, but from looking from the point of view. In other words, the traffic engineer has to be a transportation engineer, has to be a person who thinks about moving people, not cars. And if they look from the pedestrian point of view, all will make sense. It would be very easy to do. But for them to be allowed to do that, to be encouraged to do that, that's a leadership question. That's political. Just like that friend now who's in charge of bicycling at DOT, who used to oppose it. I don't know enough about the political process here to make that change. The irony is, I think the change will happen sooner than you think, because cars are going to become self-driving very quickly. And you will not need parking. You will not need any of the things that take up space now. So maybe that question will come to Singapore in a different way. But ultimately, it depends on the pedestrian point of view and acknowledging that the person is primary.
To that, nothing to add, because I agree. I would definitely add a perspective on mobility, because it's about, you know, moving from A to B to C to D, which is a mobility question. So then biking also comes into the equation, which is interesting. The only thing you could add to that is the perspective of economics. A car is a size of, 2.5 by 5.5 meters, something like that. I don't think so. Look, I'm not a specialist in cars. But suppose, something like this, 2.25 and times 5.5 meters. With one person, the costs of that car on the public space are immense. You can fit a lot of bikes in that same place and more walking people. So space is valuable in Singapore. So if you do an economic modeling, next to all the challenges cars bring to public space, you know, with the modeling of your streets and the curves and the parking place, the space they eat up, space and time. You know, we sit still, so there's a car sitting still for an hour on this 10, 15 square meters with only one person occupying space. And next to it, people are walking by and taking the subway and the bus. So the economic model of the car is failing already years. And cities like Amsterdam and New York and Copenhagen and Paris and London have catched up on it. And Amsterdam, of course, you know, we have 3 times as many bikes as people, so it's a little crazy for a country. So we have traffic jams of bikes, traffic jams of cars. It's also a little weird, but still, the understanding of that model shift and that complexity of mobility and bringing the economy into the equation is critically important for a decision maker to actually decide, oh, I can do things differently, because there are more aspects than only, am I a car or bike fan or lover? No, there is quality of life, quality of space, and quality of the economy at stake.
Yeah, there is right now, as we speak, a piece of real estate being manufactured in the island of Batam, and it will be shipped to Hawaii. This piece of real estate is 6,400 square meters, right? And it can support a load of 18,000 tons quite easily. Now, I bring this up to illustrate the fact that when we talk about sustainability and we talk about rising sea levels, consideration should be given to manufacture real estate, floating real estate. And this is particularly relevant if you're going to combat rising sea levels. Right now, I think the Americans, a company called Sea State Institute, or Sea Stating Institute, is offering a solution to the Polynesian government on a floating condominium. Right. That same can be said about it. They are building floating golf courses, floating hotels, and I'm sure in Holland you see it all the time, floating houses, right? So I thought this is something that we can consider. I just came from a conference where I delivered a paper on floating nuclear power plants in Perth just last week.
There is no silver bullet for the future. So a floating city is not the salvation or the holy grail. But yes, floating structures can be part of the equation. But I'm always afraid with silver bullets. The silver bullets most of the times miss their target. But being part of the development and opportunities for the future, yes, for sure. There's a lot of testing around the world happening on floating structures that increase environmental and ecological capacity. But mankind won't fit in a floating structure. That would actually go back, you know, we would be back in the 20s and in a siloed up approach. So can be very inspirational, but it's not the solution for everything.
Might be an opportunity to talk about the biggest picture issues, climate change. I mean, climate change is going to create parts of the earth that will lose, and climate change is going to create parts of the earth that will win. I mean, there are going to be places that will be nearly uninhabitable, but there are places now that are parched or frozen that will become very pleasant. So another way of looking at this is mobility. And if people can move from one place to another, you know, if our ancestors migrated constantly, that's part of being the human species, but in today's world, there is a huge political problem with immigration. Crossing a national border is becoming harder and harder. So the reason I bring this up and why it might be of interest to Singapore or others is let's say we're in advanced climate change and you really do have populations in the millions who either die or relocate. A solution to this is to build more cities in the winning parts of the climate change worlds. The impediment to that is transnational borders. I'll leave that political question aside, though, but go back to cities. What are cities in the broadest sense? You can go back to Aristotle, you can go back to Greek philosophy as to why cities exist, but what I found in living my life in cities and working in cities is that citizens really do one thing. Cities make citizens. They're machines for making people from anywhere into people from somewhere. New York is the greatest integrating machine the world has ever seen. So if we, in the future, are faced with a situation of moving masses of people, and we need to build entire cities, Singapore has proven that with brilliant execution and leadership, and maybe some luck, you could build a global city in, what has it been, 50 years? That's a handleable time rate. And a city, a great city, I think defines itself by making its citizens proud. And these citizens are not all ordinary. These citizens come from other places and also other backgrounds and other senses of self-worth. You can be nobody and come to a city and be somebody. Let's not lose sight of that ultimate function of a city. We may need it again sooner than we think.
Quite often, we forget that humans have lived with wildlife and nature for years. And in a way, we quite often assume that cities don't have biodiversity or native biodiversity. But that's not true, because we do have native biodiversity, and our development and goals and development and growth should take that into account. And I just would like comments from both of you on, you know, how do you ensure that biodiversity in nature, you know, can grow with the cities of, you know, that you live in, and how do you ensure, convince urban planners, developers, that biodiversity is an important part of the growth of cities?
I want to answer from the point of view of environmental law, specifically American environmental law, where in response to the huge amount of pollution in the 20th century, in around 1968, 1973, we passed a series of laws, the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, part of the National Environmental Protection Act. Very important, very effective, but it took the point of view that humans harmed nature, that nature had to be protected from humans. In some way, this is kind of an arrogant and a new view. Hundreds of thousands of years, we felt that we had to protect ourselves from nature. Well, I think Hurricane Sandy and other effects of climate change are showing us that it's a two-way street, that humans affect nature and nature affects humans. And I found that there's an impediment to building some of our resilience projects because of the environmental impact statements showing that we are having a significant effect on natural systems. In fact, it's very funny, to get your permit, you would want to get something called a FONSI, a finding of no significant impact. So it's an oxymoron. If you want to do an important project that protects you, well, you have to show that there's no significant impact. Of course it's a significant impact. And if the law can change to come to fit our new point of view, to manage a relationship, then I think we'll be able to make some real traction in the U.S. But right now we do have an impediment to change, and that is an environmental law. If the law changes and if the attitude changes, I think now we will now have a vocabulary to discuss biodiversity in cities. It won't be simply protecting the status quo, it will be building cities as we build for people, but building cities for other species as well. That we are managing this relationship. It's very diverse. It's diverse in the flora and the fauna. It's diverse in the ecological niches and the habitats. Eric Sanderson likes to say that cities are habitats for humans. And they are. But there's no habitat on Earth that is exclusive to a single species. And I think it's incredible what you've done here in Singapore with the Lush program and a point of view with your parks of integrating them fully into the city. Nature and the city are one. It gives a new meaning to concrete jungle. you are actually at the forefront of this, despite your not so good pedestrian. But I there's something in your spirit that's correct, and something in your aspiration that's inspiring. So somehow we've got to learn this from Singapore, export this idea, quantify it, get it figured out from the nitty-gritty of the laws and the finance and construction. But yeah, this, your goals make Singapore a wonderful place to certainly to visit and I assume to live.
It's interesting because it's the same question as with segregation. Everything has to be taken into account. Social, environmental, cultural, economic. They're all interests that compete for attention. And I think the city at its core, the way we started to design them, way back, were parts where those were integrated. The landscape, nature, was always part of the city. It was not a place for man and economy alone. The moment we changed it, at a certain point of view in the last century, the city became a place where it only was about economy. So, economy first, man second. I don't know what came there. Everything siloed up in buckets and no connection ruined part of the city. But a concise, comprehensive, and inclusive approach means including everything. And that inclusion has a focus on all aspects, also including ecology, habitat, and so forth. So I actually would say there is no one point that is more important than the other. Because the moment you put one first, your city will actually tip off the balance. Everything actually adds to the equation. And as Alex said, you're showing it. And there are good inspirations in older cities, great inspirations in new cities around the world. We are actually capable of dealing with those challenges. It's also the inspiring part when you work with a concise group of everyone, so social scientists, community workers, professors, politicians, designers, architects, engineers, and so forth. If you have them all in the room, all of a sudden it's about everything. And that is exactly the great thing what city making is about. That it can be about everything. It is, that complexity, that enormous challenge that is actually so amazing to work with and on. And it delivers us great places to work, live, and recreate. So, yeah, it's part of the game.
Now, this is reminding me of something that's important, another thing we can't do. In the U.S., you do here very well. Our government and our engineers typically segregate structure of infrastructure from any kind of biodiversity or biophilia. What I mean to say is that, for instance, we had a project once that we wanted to grow vines on a highway overpass in Queens. But no, we're not allowed. The natural vines are not allowed to touch the infrastructure because then how can you check the steel to make sure it's still okay? Aren't these vines going to hurt it? The Army Corps of Engineers will not allow you to plant a tree on a flood control levee because it's assumed that that tree will degrade the infrastructure. That has to change. You've changed it here in your kind of acceptance of nature into structure. With the vines growing on upper reaches of skyscrapers, of sky gardens and terraces, that's becoming commonplace here. But underneath that is an acceptance that adding nature to human-made structures doesn't degrade those structures, but somehow strengthens and enhances them. We've got to find a way of quantifying that argument and showing people in the United States that we can do the same. That our hard infrastructure will be strengthened by our soft infrastructure and not vice versa.
To build on that, there are great examples from around the world that are able already to capture those revenues. And the added value of a comprehensive approach also is, in the end, calculation. And if you silo it after Hurricane Sandy, to make it very concrete, we had 10 billion of first aid and then 50 billion of repair or recovery funding. $50 billion. Out of the 50 billion, I think 42 plus were infrastructure. And then it's sewage, rail, energy, roads, environment, water, all siloed up. All these agencies, 23 agencies, you know, all siloed up. Can you imagine that? And we assessed. So I said, you know, what's going to happen? It's all small communities. We have a mayor's office on the Jersey Shore. And then agency one comes and says, oh, I have some dollars for your roads. And then the next day, agency two comes and, oh, I have some dollars for your sewage system. And the third day for your energy. And the fourth day, it's going to be a total mess. Not only a mess in bureaucracy, but a mess in, you know, adding value or implementation or adding quality and so forth. So I said, why don't we showcase what we have? Put it on a map and see if we can, by combining those efforts, come up with a more comprehensive approach. And I bet you we're going to save dollars and add quality and get inclusion and so forth. So we analyzed all the 6,000 projects in the making, which was like a hell of a job. And we found 300 plus of them with a huge amount of interdependence, because you need it. Not everything is interdependent. Be careful. Before you know it, like, we can't walk anymore. So, 300 plus of them had this huge capacity of being interdependent. We mapped them, put all the agencies in a room. We're all siloed up from the federal, from the state, from the local level. Closed the door and said, okay, let's talk. One by one, we went through them. And then they discovered that interdependency, while mapped, brought a huge amount of opportunity when brought together and found a new way. And then came the calculation, and then came the manager. So you have to do it. It's the only way. It's not theory, it's practice. And again, it's amazing. And even within the system of the US, federal system, it was possible. Now it's a bit more scary because your siloed up legislation is now thrown out the door, which also might not be the good approach, but perhaps it gives a new opportunity for experiment.
It's regarding the closing of voucher, so which is related directly and specifically to
closing of
pedestrianization. And pedestrianization, in fact, is my own pet subject. I try very hard to pedestrianize everything I do, in fact, zero roads better. So the question is just one question, but can be broken up into four sub-questions to understand the issues involved. I call it the wall, because I cannot puncture it for so long. I think a lot of people try to close for sure. But so the four sub-questions are following. One, is it necessary to close it? Second question is, how do you defend the resistance is from LTA? That the road is arterial, cannot be closed at all. And third is, if you have to realize it, how would you do it? And the last aspect is, what's the chances of achieving this?
Automobile traffic is part of the system. If you constrain one portion of it, it rebalances in another portion. Orchard Road, a few times I visited, the main thing that is confirmed to me about it is not being able to cross the street. Either to go from one side of the street to the other, or even go that, is it Patterson or that makes you go, come on, you can't cross a grade, that's awful. But look, how that is, I don't know how, it's going to be an expression of your values, though. And the solution will, tell you what, the solution will say a lot about Singapore. And whatever you come up with, will be part of your how the world will see you. I think you can balance the street more towards pedestrians and begin that way. I don't think you should declare war one way or the other. Remember, Times Square is not closed off to traffic. In fact, the traffic flows better now because an odd angle intersection was removed. So there is most likely a way to live together on this, but I think that you have to clarify the hierarchy. And if the pedestrian is to be at the top of that hierarchy, then physical change will come. I'd be very interested to see where this goes, even be a part of helping shape it, if that's helpful. But change is coming. You can smell it in Orchard Road. Change is coming.
In Sao Paulo, we close off the streets as an experiment, you know, every week. So we can start to test. It's not a total revolutionary growth genetic in New York, but in a way it was. You know, overnight, start to build up pop-up parks, see what happened, and then people started to get adjusted and like it. So you can take an incremental approach. Don't start a war, because revolutions cause more damage than they intend to cause, except for the French, they don't believe in it. an incremental approach also has the opportunity to help change part of that culture. Step by step, builds understanding, and understanding ownership. And once the street is owned by all, including the pedestrian, you have a different thing. But perhaps you can start. A car-free day, aren't you, Pro?
Oh, yeah.
You had that?
Yes.
It didn't work?
No.
Why not?
It's not good enough.
No.
He's French.
No, I know. I understand. How was the day? So the question, not so much is, of course, it's not good enough. I totally agree. You know, but did it work on the day?
It's not permanent enough.
No. That's not my question. I agree.
To cross on a regular basis.
I totally agree. But did it function?
Yeah, I can answer the question, because we recently asked the Portugal Business Association the same question, because they were posted on, say, the last weekend. Basically, a lot of the money that we were given from the grant was actually spent to pay private security to close the street, to put up the barricades, to prevent people from falling into the pumping strip. So as a result of which, people could not seamlessly, that was achieve a vision of going in and out of the shopping malls, into the street, and around, they were actually barricaded onto the space that was the road, with designated points to get in and out of the road. So as a result of which, the retail receipts did not go up, so the building owners said, why are we doing this? It's only serving to
the wrong experiment.
So it was a wrong experiment.
We'll do it differently next time. Yeah. Don't worry. It'll be fun. Yeah.